Barakat Ayahawa, Bahashem Behaushai, Bahashem, Racha Kodash. Welcome to another live lesson. The name of this one is, it's pretty much a response to Elder Pastar's video. Back to the basics, thou shalt not abhor an Edomite, what does it mean? And pretty much, you know, this is a poor attempt by vocab to send some hood rat up to some Israelite brothers up there trying to use a scripture that she's never read in her life. She was sent up there and she was told what to go into. She never read that scripture ever in her life. She doesn't look like she's ever read the Bible. All right. She was just sent up there on a mission to try to make Israel look bad. And that's pretty much what these devils do. And they use the black woman, so-called black woman, they use the other Israelite men to try to do that. You know, I guarantee you she's never read that scripture in her mind. You know what? I was studying the other night and I ran across a scripture in Deuteronomy 23 in the law. It says, thou shalt not abhor an Edomite. I think that'll be something that I will present to these Israelite brothers to see what they say about that. No, she was sent up there. She was given a script, all right, of what to say and what to ask. All right, because that's not a scripture that people just pull out of their ass because they happen to be studying. All right, this is something that's passed down from other individuals that have been dealing with the Israelites for a long period of time. All right, and Lord's will, we're going to go into that scripture, and we're going to, you know, Elder Pastor already broke it down. We've broken it down many times. You know, I just want to say a few words on it. You know, so we're going to read it, and then we're going to get into it. Deuteronomy 23 and 7. Thou shalt not abhor an Edomite, for he is thy brother. Thou shalt not abhor an Egyptian, because thou wast a stranger in his land. How come you never hear a bleeding heart? What about the Egyptians? You know, thou shalt not abhor an Egyptian, because thou wast a stranger in his land. What's up with the Egyptian? How come you never hear that? Why is it always the Edomite? Because this is the individuals that are ruling today. All right? And that's why it's always about the Edomites. Jake is not concerned about anybody else but the so-called white man being delivered. He would put the so-called white man in front of themselves to be delivered before they would be able to get delivered. It's called Stockholm Syndrome. And as you've heard Elder Pastor say, the word abhor does not mean to hate. The word abhor simply means to avoid. Now, my question that I had years ago to these individuals that try to use this scripture, the scriptures say that precept must be upon precept, line upon line, here a little and there a little. So my question to them was, and still is, show me another scripture in the Bible that gives, besides this scripture here, that gives Esau any form of leniency, any form of mercy. And they cannot. The weakest attempt was an individual back in the days we used to call false prophet 666, and he tried to bring out, well, you know, so and so was a Jew, you know, talking about the Herods, that they were Jew and Jewesses, and that was his rebuttal, you know, to my asking him, give me a scripture where it shows any of these Edomites, you know, any form of mercy, and they couldn't, and they can't. You know, so this is not talking about an actual Edomite, and Lord's will get into it. And even your biblical scholars that put together these Bible dictionaries, this one in particular is the Zondervan's Bible Dictionary. And here, when you look up the word Edom, I'm not sure if it's Esau or Edom, I believe it's Edom. And it says Edom figures prominently in the prophetic scriptures as a scene of great future judgment. See, notably Isaiah 34, 5 and 6. And Isaiah 63 and 1. She is the only neighbor of the Israelites who was not given any promise of mercy from the Most High. And it's the same narrative all throughout the Bible. From their birth all the way until the end. Esau being the end of the world and Jacob being the it that followeth. So there's nowhere in the Bible that it gives these devils any form of mercy. So what is this speaking about in Deuteronomy 23:7? You know, seeing that it's affording mercy towards this particular individual, which are not the Edomites. They're really the Syrians, you know. And when you understand, you know, the narrative of the Bible, and you understand the history of the Bible, you understand how Abraham, who was a father of who was a son of Terah, had two other brothers, one named Haran, the other one named Nahor. Haran died in the, I believe he died in the land of their nativity. And when they went to Syria, that particular land, Haran or Charan, was named after their brother. Now, I don't remember if he actually died in Ur or if he died in this land here. And they named it after his brother, Haran or Charan. All right. So there were descendants there of this particular man, Haran. And Abraham had descendants there in that land known as Syria. This is why when Jacob came of age, where did they send him to? Well, actually, Isaac. Where did Isaac get his wife from? He got his wife from that region. Where did Jacob get his wife from, or his wives from? He got them from the same region, because that was the place where Abraham's kin was. That was the line that the Most High wanted to be the brides, so to speak, of Abraham, Abraham's son, Isaac, and his grandson, Jacob. Okay? So when we look up this word, thou shalt not abhor an Edomite, the word abhor does not mean hate. It means to avoid. We look up the word Edomite. The word there says Adamaya, you know, which down here says Adawamya, Adamya, but it's not Adawamya, because Esau's name is not Adama or Adamya. It's Adawam or Adawamya. Really Adawam. The name Adam is a totally different word. The word Edom, Adawam, means red. The word Adam, Adama, means ground. So these devils, they like to play, you know, with the numbers game. And that's why I don't really hold too tough to these lettering, Strong's lettering, or numbering system. It's just a way to identify what word is what. But then they try to say, well, this word is a root word to this word, and then this word means this. And they try to tie, they always try to tie Adawam or Adawamya with Adam. Two separate words. Adam means ground. Edomite means red. So when you go here under the KJV translation count, it says total 12 times. The KJV translates Strong's H130 in the following manner. Edomite or Edomites 11 times. Syria 1 time. You see? And this is what should be there. The word Syria or Syrian should have been what should have been there. So thou shalt not abhor a Syrian, because he is thy brother. All right. When we jump down, it says Edomite there. And we come down here to the Strong's definition. It says Adamaya or Edomi, or fully Adawamya, patronymic from H123, CH726. An Edomite or descendant from or inhabitant of Edom, Edomite. Now, in most cases where you see the number, this number here, H123, is talking about the actual Edomites, like in the case of what was that name of that Edomite devil? The Lord raised up an adversary to Solomon. I don't remember. It was Hadad the Edomite or something like that. I forget his name, but in that case, that was an actual Edomite. But in the case of Deuteronomy 23:7, it was not talking about an Edomite. It was talking about a Syrian, H726. When you go to H726, right here it says Arawamya or arum. This is where you get the term or word arum. It says a clerical error for Adamaya, H-130. Right, because there was a point in there where this was an actual error. All right, and that error happened to come in Deuteronomy 23 and 7. But there was another error where this word Syrian appears where it should have been Edomite. So sometimes where the word Syrian is should be Esau or Edom. And sometimes where the word Edom or Edomite is should be Syria. It depends on the context of the scripture. We come straight down, Aramite, Syrian. A clerical error for H-130, an Edomite, as in margin, Syrian. All right, and we go down here to the book of 2 Kings 16 and 6. Let's go there. It says, at that time, Rezin, king of Syria, recovered Elath to Syria and drave the Jews from Elath, and the Syrians came to Elath and dwelt there unto this day. That's not what should be there. What should be there is the Edomites. Here, New King James Version, at that time, Rezin, king of Syria, which that's who was supposed to be there, captured Elath for Syria and drove the men of Judah from Elath. Then the Edomites went to Elath and dwelt there unto this day. At that time, this is the NLT, at that time, the king of Edom, which that's not supposed to be, they're supposed to be the king of Syria, recovered the town of Elath for Edom. He drove out the people of Judah and sent Edomites to live there as they do this day. All right. At that time, Rezin, king of Aram, which is correct, recovered Elath from Aram, for Aram, by driving out the people of Judah. Edomites then moved into Elath and have lived there to this day, because that land was being fought back and forth between the Israelites and the Edomites. And you know, it goes on and on. You know, it speaks about the king of Syria that recovered that land, and the Edomites came and dwelt there. So in this case, 2 Kings 16 and 6, the word that should have been there is Edomite and not Syrian. Just like in, because that's a clerical error, just like in Deuteronomy 23 and 7, the word that should be there is Syrian and not Edomite. Thou shalt not abhor a Syrian or avoid a Syrian. Why? Because although we were supposed to deal with only amongst ourselves, these people that were living in Syria, which were kin of Abraham, that was allowed for our, you know, the men of our nation to deal with those women. All right. Let's go to Deuteronomy 26. I believe that's Deuteronomy 26. And 4. And the priest shall take the basket out of thine hand and set it down before the altar of the Lord thy power. And thou shalt speak and say before the Lord thy power, a Syrian ready to perish was my father. Who was this? This was dealing with Jacob. I used to think years ago that it was dealing with Abraham, but it wasn't. It was dealing with Jacob. And he went down into Egypt and sojourned there with a few and became there a nation great, mighty, and populous. So pretty much he was an Israelite that came from the land of Syria, because that was the journey that his father, that his forefather Abraham took from Ur to Syria down into the land of Canaan. All right. So that's why I said the Syrian ready to perish was my father. And this is where Jacob took his wives from. And even when you go to Isaac himself, let's go to Isaac. Let's go to the book of Deuteronomy 25 and 19. I'm sorry, not Deuteronomy. I got Deuteronomy on the brain. Genesis 25 and 19. It says what? Isaac's sons. And these are the generations of Isaac, Abraham's son. Abraham begat Isaac, and Isaac was 40 years old when he took Rebekah to wife, the daughter of who? Bethuel, the what? The Syrian of Padanaram, the sister to Laban, the Syrian. So here it is. This is the area where you had the Syrians, or the kin of Abraham, living in this land, being named Syrians because they were not of the line of Aram, one of Shem's five sons. They were of that land. That's what they were called by the name of that land. They were not of the line of Aram, which is one of the five sons of Shem. All right, so it says, took the daughter of Bethuel, the Syrian of Padanaram. We look up the word Syrian, you have what? H761, Aramia. You know, this is another word that goes into the word Syrian, because they were living in that land. All right, Syrian Aramaitis. All right. Let's go back, because it mentioned the word Padanaram. Some say Padanaram. So see, Padanaram. You know, it's a compound word. So Padan is field, a plain or tableland in northern Mesopotamia, in Aram, a region of what? Syria. You see? And Syria was just above the land of Israel. All right, so when you understand the history of Abraham and the journey that he took, that he had kin in that land that took that his son Isaac and Isaac's son Jacob took wives from there, and these are good precepts that brother put up here. Let's pull up some of these. Genesis 22:20. And it came to pass after these things that it was told Abraham, saying, behold, Milcah, she hath also borne children unto thy brother Nahor, right? Huz, his firstborn, and Buz, his brother, and Kemuel, the father of what? Aram. Now, this is a different Aram from the Aram in Genesis, the 10th chapter. It just happened to be a name that was given to this particular son. The word Aram simply means exalted. It was a common name among Hebrews. Then you had Enkasat and Hazah and Pildash and Jitlaf and Bethuel. See? Of that line. It says, and Bethuel begat Rebekah. These eight Milcah did bear to Nahor, Abraham's brother. So this is where both Isaac and Jacob got their wives from. That's why it says, thou shalt not abhor an Edomite, which really should be a Syrian, for he is thy brother. That's the true understanding of this scripture here. Thou shalt not abhor a Syrian, for he is thy brother. And when you go to Genesis, in the same book of Genesis 29, and we're dealing with Laban and we're dealing with Jacob, right, I'm not sure what verse it is, so just bear with me. I believe it's the 29th chapter. Right, beautiful. So let's start at 13. And it came to pass when Laban heard the tidings of Jacob, his sister's son, that he ran to meet him and embraced him and kissed him and brought him to his house. And he told Laban all these things. And Laban said to him, surely thou art my bone and my flesh. And he abode with him the space of a month. And Laban said unto Jacob, because thou art my brother, shouldest thou therefore serve me for naught? Tell me, what shall thy wages be? So he said, thou art my brother. That's why he said, thou shalt not abhor a Syrian, for he is thy brother. These are your near kinsmen through Abraham's brothers, Nahor and Haran. And that's pretty much what it means. You know, and I'll leave it there because the point is made. You know, so all of this, oh, well, thou shalt not abhor an Edomite. This woman was sent, trust and believe this woman was sent. She was given that scripture. She doesn't know what the hell she's talking about. She's never read that scripture in her life until it was shown to her. And she's out here trying to make, you know, Israelites look bad. So I say fuck her. And fuck vocab. All right? Because that's what the devil does. You know, trying to make the ISUPK look bad. You know, which, you know, we have our differences with them. You know, on different things. Scriptural wise, not personal. But when it comes to scriptures, I'm sorry, when it comes to personal things, we don't deal with personal things. It's all the Father's business, Yahweh Bashem El Shai's business. You know, so for these people, the vocab and his minions coming up, the hell with them. They're nothing more than the devil that the Bible speaks of. All right, and all of you that help this devil, guess what? You're furnishing the table for that devil. You're going to partake in the same punishment that he partakes in. All right. So with that, I pray that you brothers and few sisters have been edified. To the next time I say Shalom.